Okay, so due to some reviews that I've gotten, I'm not going to be drilling the hello everybody sentence anymore, or I will try not to do it anyway. But rather instead, I'm just gonna jump into the tutorial itself right away. So today we're gonna do something different from what we've done thus far. This is a common problem encountered by tech support people and companies or forensics. The police or something of a kind, or private companies as well. You generally get a machine, if you're working the forensics, whether you are working for the police force or whether you are working for a private company that is a contractor for the police or something of a kind, you will inevitably encounter system passwords that you will need to bypass. That can be extremely problematic. For example, if somebody has encrypted their drives, it is with a strong enough encryption key, it is unlikely that you will ever manage to pull anything out of those drives. Now, we're not going to be dealing with the encrypted drives today, as that is pretty much impossible, but or highly unlikely, I would say. Rather, instead, we will be dealing with system passwords. Now, usually what the forensics would do is insert a bootable CD or a USB and boot it from there. However, a lot of the systems, you get logged in by some default user. For example, my default user here is test. It doesn't have any root privileges of whatsoever, but I am able to actually do some basic operations on the system which do not require root access. Now, from this user mode, I want to acquire a root password so that I can actually control the system to the fullest of extents and see what is going on there. Now, I can't actually control the system from a bootable CD, rather instead I can control that particular system which runs from a bootable CD and then access the files here. And this is also one of the methods that is very nice. You can extract password hashes and then crack them later on or something of a kind. But today, what I wanted to show you, this particular method, is when people forget their passwords or something of a kind, you don't necessarily want to go into the through the trouble of actually booting from a CD, then getting a hash, and then after you've gotten the hash, you then need to crack it, and so on and so forth. Rather, instead, I will show you a method where you can obtain root access without that by just rebooting the system and changing a few things there. And then afterwards, we will use that method, or we will use the one with the CD to acquire the hash as well. And then I will show you how to crack that hash with John the Ripper. Anyway, without further ado, let's just go ahead and reboot the system. So I'm just logged in as test here. Let's just type in reboot. Oops, I do need to, I can just use the graphical interface to reboot the system. Or you can just physically turn the machine off and on, off and on. Oh, come on, where are you? Hibernate, restart. As I said, you can physically turn the machine on and off, and that's gonna qualify as a restart. So, okay, it is now in the process of booting. Grub is loading, and immediately after the grub loads, move the error up and down so that the timer actually stops. Go ahead and press. You see there are these options here. It says use up and down arrow keys to select which entry is highlighted. Press enter to boot the selected OS or E to edit those commands before booting. So what we want to do is press E, and there's a whole bunch of things here. It's kind of difficult to see. I can't make it any clearer for you, unfortunately. There is one line which is very clear where I am now. It says echo loading Linux 318 Kali AMD 64. I'm sure you see that one. Down below immediately there is Linux slash boot VM Linus 318 something. And down below that line you have this number string. Well, it's the same line, I think. Let me just move the arrow. Come on. Excellent, there we go. So it's the same line, basically. It just can't fit into the screen. Maybe on your computer it will. So there is this long number. It says here 957-A28 and so on and so forth. And after that line, immediately it says R O Due to the background, it's a little bit difficult to see, but on your systems, you will be able to see it with more clarity. But anyway, after this number, 957-A2 something, there is a space, and then there is RO. Delete the RO, type in RW. Go to the end of that line, don't change anything else. Go to the end, press space, type in init, init equals slash bin, so bin slash bash. So it's bash. Excellent. So let's see how do we actually save this. Press Control C or F10 to boot. F10, where is the F10? Excellent. So I just pressed F10 and it's booting up now. Let's see what happens. Excellent, there we go. So I am prompted with a root shell. See, I am root on my system now. You can see in the left corner of the screen that I am root here. Of course, this would be in full screen mode, but you can't actually load VirtualBox guest editions while you are booting it like this, so the screen will be rather small. Anyway, it says root at none, but doesn't really matter. I can do whatever I want. I can go ahead and clear the screen. I can cd to root. As you see, I have full access to the system, and from here, I can pretty much do anything. For example, I can do init slash 5. Come on, no such file there. Do you have start x? Nope, you do not have start x. Fantastic. I have config. No network configuration either, primarily because I am in this mode, which is fantastic, but it doesn't matter. I can do a lot of things to the system. For example, just to give you an example, here we go, cd home test us. So I am in the test, and now I can do pass wd, type in test, and I can change the password for test. I can even do pass wd for root, and I can change the password for root. Let's do that. So pass wd for root, what shall it be? The new password, I'm just gonna type in exactly the same one as I've typed in before, but you get the idea. You can type in whatever you want here. Excellent. So it says pass wd password updated successfully. Now what we want to do is reboot and do a regular boot. So we get the graphical user interface as well, and we get full screen here in VirtualBox, and we get a bit of a prettier environment as well. So just go ahead and reboot. You will of course need to undo the changes that have been done. Could not determine the run level. Doing soft reboot. It's better to use shutdown instead. Okay, so this approach comes with certain problems. Let's just power off the machine. You do not wish to power off as well. Amazing. As you can see, this does come with a few drawbacks. It is not as convenient, but oh well. Doesn't really matter. You can what you would do in a physical machine then, if you don't want to bother yourself with figuring out what the problem is here. I of course have to go like this, and you'll probably have to do it like this on your virtualizer, which is probably VirtualBox, but I have seen that some people have been using VMware in the discussion section as they've had some problems with the VirtualBox. As I said, you can either try to figure out what is the problem here, and it says it's better to use shutdown instead of power off on the command line or something like that. You can try typing in some other commands, but honestly, why bother? Just press the reset button on your computer and let that be the end of it. So reset. It's booting up. Welcome to grub. Okay, so proceed to edit. Let's just go and oh, excellent. That has been deleted by default and it's a clean. So if you mess something up here, just reboot the machine and the cleanup operation will be done for you. Exit from here. I don't really want. Oh, come on, don't bug on me now. Never mind, we're just gonna reset it again. Not a good idea to do these sort of things in a VirtualBox. They tend to or pretty much any virtualizer. Maybe on Xen it wouldn't be a problem, but they can present problems in our VirtualBox, primarily because it is not a physical machine. It doesn't work in ex I mean, not in exactly the same way. Anyway, I am rebooting it here, and we're gonna get into the system, and we will be root. So not yet, but now we know the password because we have changed it. Although this method does not enable you to actually get the password itself. Rather, instead, it allows you to only change it. But we obviously needed to do that because we need root password if we are to actually access the etc passwd and etc shadow file where the password is actually hashed. And let me just show you that. This is where Linux stores its password. You need to become root for this, and now we know the root password. So let's just type in, well, not nano, but even better, cat etc shadow. Excellent. So you see here it says test, which is my user, and then there is some sort of a hash over here that is not pretty to look at. But what can you really do about it? You can crack it, I suppose, but that's about it. And excellent. And here is the root is the first one, and then there's the hash here as well. Now we need to actually crack this. Let me just go ahead and clear the screen. In the follow-up tutorial, I'm gonna show you how you can actually extract this hash and how you can crack it. Now, this particular tutorial, or these few tutorials, will be for a Linux type system, and then we'll move on in the next few tutorials to a Windows-based system. But remember that we need to obtain root privileges on a system before, or admin privileges on a Windows system before we will be able to do these sort of things in order to extract the passwords themselves. Why should you do this? I mean, if you already have root access to the system, well, you might want to extract the system password primarily because people tend to repeat the passwords, and they might have used it elsewhere or something of a kind, or your contractor might just say, "Hey, I want the password. I don't necessarily want just root access, but rather instead I want the password," for whatever reasons. As I said, people tend to distribute them over the other accounts or something of a kind, and then they can use it to log in elsewhere as well. In any case, I bid you farewell, and I hope to see you in the follow-up tutorial.